Hello. Good morning. How are you guys doing? Good. That was awesome, guys. Thank you so much. That was beautiful. Baby Luca liked it too, and he was showing me with that with bladder punches. So that was fun. It was like, whoa, okay. I'm Harmony. This is Luca. I'm obviously pregnant, very pregnant. And if I forget what I'm saying in the middle of a sentence, I ask you to have grace for me. Not only do I have pregnancy brain, but also my blood pressure is plummeting from time to time. So that'll be fun. I don't know. How many of you guys have kids? So many of you. Wow. Okay. So I have friends who are like, oh my gosh, I'm pregnant. I need a rubber band for my jeans in CrossFit. And I'm so cute. And I'm like, I can't walk. I have plantar fasciitis. I have sciatica. Like my blood pressure, I'm dizzy. So anyways, that's just real. But this is super exciting. I mostly still have ankles. And I'm really happy about that. Although, let's be real, this is the last pair of shoes I fit, and this is the last day I'm going to be wearing them, because I've grown out of them. With my daughter, I had a swelling problem, and I would like to do a little show and tell if that's okay with you. So, in just a second, I'm going to show you a picture. And the best thing about this picture is when I started having a crush on the young man, who is now, he's not that young, he's older than me, but handsome man, who is now my husband, I was getting a little bit like, oh my gosh, this is Chris Grillo, I can't have a crush on him, I'm just going to squash this. And so my strategy was to say to him one day, as you do, have you ever seen my labor photos? And to which he replied, no, I haven't. And I decided to show him this photograph. Here we go. That's my feet at 6 months pregnant. They got more swollen. I wish I had documented it. And that's my face. And if you'll notice, you can't see my teeth, although I'm smiling. So my plan was, to just kind of let him know who he's dealing with here. And it backfired because he said later, he thought, what kind of crazy girl is so comfortable and confident she would show these pictures. So then for our wedding night, I gave him a t-shirt with this montage on it, and it says Mrs. Grillo on it, and he wore it for our whole honeymoon. So the fact that I have ankles is a Christmas miracle, and so I'm very excited. I usually come here for the trafficking conference. How many of you guys come to that? Anti-trafficking, I guess we should say. I love when people say to me, I'm getting involved in trafficking, and I'm like, really? Do you think that's a good idea? Aren't we kind of trying to prevent that? So the anti-trafficking conference, and it's really great. And as Kelly mentioned earlier, we've been partnering with you guys for 6 years. I run an outreach and support group to women in the commercial sex industry and victims of trafficking. And I love what I get to do. We do outreach in strip clubs, in juvenile detention centers where youth are trafficked, who are there have been trafficked and exploited. We also do outreach into the porn industry through HIV testing sites and in online forums where women and girls are sold and solicited for sex. And we provide them with mentoring, a therapist-led, or actually no longer a therapist-led support group. It's now survivor-led support group. And we found that the women are responding much better to that and showing up more. So that's been great. And we just build community. And we just give them a place to heal and to grow. An example of that is next week we're actually having our Christmas party for the women and for their children, and we just shower them with love and gifts. Our supporters send in gifts for them. We have like the whole Amazon wish list thing going, and it's really precious. And actually last year I was walking down one of the young girls after the Christmas party, walking her to her car. And she said, she's someone who was raised in foster care, who had been trafficked as a youth, and had a pretty rough life. And when we got in the elevator, she said, Harmony, thank you so much. I've never done that before. And I was thinking like, had a Christmas party? Like, what have you not done? I said, what do you mean you haven't done that before? She said, I've never opened a Christmas gift by a tree. And so it's just really precious that we get to provide a sense of family and community for the women. Actually, so much so, family, that one of the women I mentor mentors another young woman who has a crazy story we don't have time for. And after a number of years, they grew so close, although they're both adults, the woman I mentor legally adopted the woman that she mentors. So now she's a mom and a grandma. So it's beautiful the way God restores family. If you are interested in learning more about treasures, I invite you to visit our table in the, what are they calling it? The crafting lobby, the boutique. Yes, we're there. My young, handsome husband will be there at the table. And so we encourage you to come by. If you're interested in just learning more or becoming a partner with us, praying with us, we'd love to have you be a part of it. So I was on sabbatical. I think I was on sabbatical when Kelly asked me to come speak, and I was mostly saying no to everything, but I got so excited when she asked me to come here today. And to be honest, a little bit selfishly, this is a really big marker moment for me, because the first time I ever came and spoke at Murrieta was 6 years ago, at this very women's conference during Christmas. And it's crazy to see what God has done in my life in 6 years. And just to kind of set things up for you, so the conference was on a Saturday morning. The day before the conference, I spent the whole day moving because I lost my home after a very painful divorce. And you know, it was in the middle of the housing crisis. There was no way to keep it. I, you know, fought with the banks, tried to keep it, and ended up losing my house, single mom, you know, having to just navigate all of that and the pain of a divorce. And so it was, I think it was December 5th or 6th. I can't remember which exact day, but I was broke as a joke, you know, because I had lost the second income that I had come to rely on, and all that stuff. And it was to the point where I just said, you know what? It's December 6th. I don't have money. I'm not even going to get a Christmas tree this year, even though that broke my heart for my daughter. Oh my gosh, I'm so pregnant. I'm like, I'm crying at my own story. It's so bad, you guys. I watch This Is Us, and I'm like in tears, like hysterically every week. But don't talk to me about it, because I'm behind episodes, so please don't tell me anything. So it was to the point where I said, you know what, I'm not even going to do a Christmas tree this year. We can't really afford it. It's almost Christmas anyways. And so after moving all day long, I drove, you know, the 2 hours down to Murrieta from where I live. And I walked into the hotel room that this community had set up for me, and they knew what I was going through, and they had it decorated all Christmas with a mini Christmas tree that I got to take home. So I did have a Christmas tree that year for my daughter and I. And one of the gifts that I remember they had laying out for me was this beautiful soft gray blanket that had, the theme that year was peace. And it had "Wrapped in Peace" written on it. And still to this day, my daughter, every single morning, the only way I can get her out of bed is to wrap her in that blanket for her to have her breakfast. So it was a super difficult time in my life that day. And here I am 6 years later, and my life has drastically changed. I'm in a completely different season. I'm married to an incredible man who is a wonderful father to my daughter. And we actually just bought a home and moved in 4 weeks ago. Great, like mind blowing. And I'm obviously pregnant with a baby, a human baby. So that's super exciting, a boy baby. And it's just beautiful, the redemptive work that God has done. Even the fact that this particular season is this place of moving into a new house and being pregnant is exactly the place in my life I was in when my ex-husband began having affairs. And so it's been really interesting and sort of triggering, because I'm like, whoa, it's the same circumstances, but things are turning out much differently. And I would be lying to you if I didn't say it's kind of made things a little nutty for me. I'm like, ah, this is crazy. I'm kind of scared, but I have to trust God through it. And so anyways, it's beautiful. So yeah, seasons have definitely shifted for me. And you know, the truth is being Christian does not make us immune to the troubles of life, right? And so, Even though I was Christian following God and I was in ministry, still I found myself facing some very, very painful circumstances in that season. And the truth is that in this world, we will have trouble. We will have trouble, but we can take heart because he has overcome the world. And that's John 16:33. We will have trouble, but he has overcome the world. And this season can be hard. The holiday seasons can be super hard for a lot of people, right? It's for a lot of us, it's exciting and joy-filled, and there's so much beauty in it. And at the same time, there are those of us who are faced with grief, with loss, with broken relationships, with just unmet expectations, things that we hoped, you know, we'd have this person with us in this season, or we hoped that our life would look a certain way, or that our parents could arrive for us in this season. This is something I personally deal with, and I might get to share some of that part of my story with you in a little while. And there's this gap between kind of the joy that's going on around us and the grief that some of us are carrying in our hearts, right? And then on top of it, as Kelly mentioned, we're in a season in history where things are a little crazy, right? There's political tensions like never before, or maybe, I'm sure it's, well, there's nothing new under the sun, but let's just say there's a lot of political tension right now, right? And on top of that, issues of injustice are rising to the surface. And in some ways, I think we're becoming awakened to issues of injustice. And that's kind of like, that's awesome because we can do something about it. And at the same time, it's kind of jolting, right? We're becoming newly aware of racism and sexism and issues of sex trafficking, mass incarceration. It can be a very difficult time for us to just feel filled with hope, right? But because there's this gap between reality as we're experiencing it and what our hopes and expectations are of the way things should be, right? So it's difficult. And yet we know that the Word of God says, I know the plans that I have for you, plans to prosper you, not to harm you, to give you a hope and a future. And that's Jeremiah 29:11. And so that is truth. Despite the circumstances of maybe our personal grief, the hurt that we experienced during the holidays, or even the way we're feeling about the state of our world, this is still true, right? And so I want to just spend some time today talking about the truth about hope, the truth about hope. And the first thing I want to say is that hope looks very different depending on where we place it. Our hope, the outcome of hope looks very different depending on where we place it. On one hand, in Proverbs 13:12, it says that hope deferred makes the heart sick. Hope deferred makes the heart sick. On the other hand, Hebrews 6:19, and this is one of my favorites, says that we have this hope, meaning hope in Jesus, as an anchor for our souls, firm and secure. So on one hand, the Bible paints this picture of hope when it's deferred, makes our hearts sick and heavy and hurting. And on the other hand, hope in Jesus is an anchor for our soul, firm and secure. And so I think this kind of begs the question, how do we respond when our hope is deferred? How do we respond when our hopes and expectations are not met or even disappointed, completely shattered? How do we respond, and where are we going to place our hope? And so just to backtrack a little bit to bring you up to where I was before the day I came here 6 years ago, as Kelly mentioned, Treasures is a survival-led organization. And what that means is that I am a survivor of sexual exploitation. And to give you a very brief synopsis of my story, you know, I, like many women and girls who are in the commercial sex industry and victims of exploitation, I have a history of rape and abuse and just a lot of family dysfunction, domestic violence. My mother was a cocaine addict. My dad was a drug dealer. And I found myself abandoned by my mother at the age of 13 and left alone with my 8-year-old brother for 3 months. Yes, I'm so glad the children are leaving. Actually, if there are any other young children in here, this is probably, I don't know if this is the best message for them. And so I was abandoned by my mother at the age of 13 and left to take care of my 8-year-old brother for 3 months with $20 and a book of food stamps, which are government vouchers for food. And obviously, once the food stamps were gone, and the $20 was gone. I didn't have any way to provide for us, so I began stealing from the liquor store to support my brother and I. And eventually what happened is I became involved with an older boy in the neighborhood who would come around and buy us food. I lived in a really gang-ridden neighborhood where there was a gang war between the two gangs in my neighborhood. And, you know, so it was very violent. And he made me feel protected because he would tell me, I'll take care of you. I've got your back, right? And he made me feel provided for because he bought us food. And so I entered this relationship with him that eventually became this 7-year-long, completely abusive relationship that led me into the sex industry. And essentially, he became my pimp. And I was in a very desperate and hopeless, very broken place. And I'm sorry to be speeding through this, but we don't have time for the whole thing because I want to get to the rest of the message. But what's really funny is that, no, I don't know if you call it funny, but at that time in my life, I sometimes would go walking through this neighborhood that, you know, at this point I had moved out of Venice and moved to West LA. And I would walk through this neighborhood where there were single family homes, like middle class single family homes. And I would find myself just longing for the life that I imagined they had behind those doors. I would see the children's toys scattered in the lawn, and I would see, you know, mothers playing with their children, and I would look through the windows and imagine the family dinners that they had, and I wanted that life so bad. And yet the reality of my circumstances were vastly different from that. I was working in the sex industry with my boyfriend who was my pimp, who was abusive, right? But that picture of home and family became something that I hung onto and clung to, that I hoped beyond hope that one day I would have that, right? And so after, you know, long story short, fast forwarding, I give my life to Jesus. I leave the exploitation. I leave the boyfriend. I leave that whole life behind. And I have to say, if I'm honest, you know, in my faith, I found transformation. I found healing. I found hope, and those that is real and true. And if I'm honest, I thought I found the perfect formula for the perfect life. I thought if I just do what the Bible says and plant a certain seed, then I will reap a certain harvest and everything will be just perfect, right? And that was my expectation and that was my hope. And, you know, at first it kind of seemed to be working. Like, so I had incredible healing, incredible transformation, and met a Christian man, and we got married, and things were going so great. And I remember being in a servant's once, and I heard this woman preaching, and she was like, if you're in a difficult time right now, if you're just in a really hard season, I want to encourage you that this too shall pass. And I couldn't really connect with that at the moment because things were going so great, right? I was like jealous of my own self. and then she said, if you're like on a mountaintop right now and things are going awesome, I want to encourage you that this too shall pass. I was like, I rebuke you in the name of Jesus. No, not gonna happen. Like, I'm sowing the right seeds. I'm reading the right books. I'm going to church. Like, I'm serving. I'm doing tithing. I'm doing everything I'm supposed to do, right? And yet, like I said, being Christian doesn't make us immune to the troubles of life. And so for me, when I found out that my husband was having affairs and ultimately wasn't willing to do the work that it took to bring restoration to our marriage, and was found myself in this financial position where I was losing everything, I had a decision to make. Where was I going to put my hope? Was my hope going to be in the dream that I had for that white picket fence home and family? And if so, that was all falling apart. Or was my hope going to be in Jesus himself, in Jesus himself? And what God showed me is that things were going to look different depending on where my hope was. If my hope was in that dream of the white picket fence reality, then I was going to be shattered. Right? I was going to fall apart right along with my life. But if I placed my hope in Jesus, it would be firm and secure, that it would not be easily shaken, and that even though everything was going crazy all around me, I could still stand firm on him, my rock. And that's what I chose to do. So I just encourage you to ask yourself, where is your hope today? Where is your hope today? And even though things are great right now for me, and life is seasonal, and I don't even want to talk about this will pass. But I mean, things are, we're in a sweet, sweet season. You know, being married in a good place in our marriage, having this new home that we love. And yet, I remember looking at my husband and saying to him when we were in our apartment in the medium hood, I like to call it the medium hood, because it wasn't quite the hood. It was kind of like medium hood. So it wasn't like gunshots every night, but it was like shopping carts, you know, and like furniture on the corner and, you know, people on the street just drinking 40s kind of thing. But they're not shooting each other, so it's just medium hood. And we were, you know, living there well, that's where I lived. I can't say, was so excited about moving in with me. We didn't want so many transitions for my daughter, so he decided to move in with us so we can keep some stability for her. And that wasn't his favorite thing, but he did it. He's a trooper. And but the thing is that when we were in the process of looking for a home to buy, we would look at each other and say, you know, the best thing about this is we are so content right now. We were totally fine in our medium hood apartment. And anything else would just be icing on the cake. And even now, as someone who still craves safety and stability, it's something that, coming from a history of trauma and chaos, it's something that's sort of hardwired into me. I have to look around my house and constantly remind myself, as amazing and beautiful as this is, and how much I can just enjoy this gift that I'm stewarding, that it's not mine, I'm stewarding. My hope is not in the house, right? Because it's just a temporary thing. My hope is still has to be in Jesus, because that's the only firm and secure place for it. So I encourage you to ask yourself, where is your hope today? Where are you placing your hope today? Blessed are those whose help is in the God of Jacob, whose hope is in the Lord their God. Psalm 146, 5. But those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength. They will soar on wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not be faint. Isaiah 40:31. Where is your hope? The second thing, the truth about hope, is that hope and grief are not mutually exclusive. I'll let you think about that. Grief and hope are not mutually exclusive. What that means is that they coexist. They can and often do coexist. They can happen simultaneously. And I think in the church today, especially in America, I think we've gotten to a place where we're really good at celebration and praise, and that's awesome. And talking about victory and overcoming, and that is also awesome. That is God's heart and desire for us, right? But I think that in many of the churches that I've been to, we've lost perspective on the significance of lament and how important lament is, and that there's biblical precedent for lament, and that there is a time and a place for lament, and that God is sensitive and compassionate towards those who grieve and mourn, right? And he calls us to be sensitive and compassionate to those who mourn, and to mourn with them, in fact. But the truth is that grief makes us sort of uncomfortable, right? Who likes grief? No, right? Nobody likes grief. As a matter of fact, I remember after the separation, I had this revelation, thank you, Jesus, that my recovery did not have to depend on my ex-husband's recovery, that I could heal and get better even if he never chose to. And so what that meant for me is I decided to fully pursue and dive into the healing work that God wanted to do in my life in the middle of that separation and that very painful season. And I had gone through, the 12-step recovery groups for codependency, people in relationship with those struggling with addictions. And I had read all the town and hounds and books, and I had been pursuing recovery like hardcore, right? And I got a Christmas gift from a friend, and she said she was going to give me 10 weeks of free babysitting. And I was like, praise the Lord, I'm going salsa dancing. Like, I'm having fun. And I believe in fun. I can do a whole message on fun. I believe in fun. And then at the same time, a friend of mine said, hey, I'm leading a grief recovery group. It's 10 weeks. Would you like to come? And I said, no, thank you. And she said, would you pray about it? I was like, yeah, Okay, fine. And of course, because I said I would pray about it, I had to like technically pray about it. So I was like, God, if you want me to go to the grief recovery, just show me, and if not, forget it. Right? And kind of hoping, like, I was just kind of hoping he'd forget the prayer. Oh my gosh. I went on a retreat, and the whole weekend, all I kept hearing is, your pain is grief. Your pain is grief. And I was like, I'm gonna have to take that freaking grief recovery, and I can't go salsa dancing instead. And it was like the worst thing. I was so grumpy about it too, but so thankful I went through it, because I was grieving. I was grieving the loss of my marriage. I was grieving the loss of the life I thought I could have, and I needed healing for that grief, and it was uncomfortable, and I didn't like it. And yet, we have to grieve. And just some tips for free. When people are grieving, some of these things don't help. Like when someone loses someone who dies, saying, well, they're in a better place, that doesn't help, okay? When someone's going through a divorce, well, maybe, you know, God will restore your marriage, or you'll have another husband someday, doesn't help, okay? You know, my husband and I, before this child, we lost 4 babies in a row, and it was heartbreaking and devastating, and I praise God that this one is with us. But when people came to me and said, well, at least you already have one child, or at least you can get pregnant, or, you know, you've got a lot of babies in heaven. I mean, I hear this so good and so well-intentioned, right? But these things don't tend to help those who are grieving. And we are called to grieve with those who grieve, to mourn with those who mourn, and rejoice with those who rejoice. And sometimes I think we get it backwards, and we try to get those who are mourning to rejoice with us when they're not ready. So sometimes we just need to be present and sit with people in their grief. And so I want to spend some time looking at the story of Lazarus in John 11. And the story is that Jesus receives word that Lazarus is sick and dying. And Jesus' response to this is, he says, this sickness will not end in death. No, it is for God's glory, so that that God's son may be glorified through it. So that's the promise, right? This sickness will not end in death. And as we are going through the story, I want you to think about, is there a promise that God has given you? Is there a promise that God has given you? I can say that during that season I've been talking about, the promise that God gave me is that God would restore family to me, and that he would redeem my dreams. That was the promise. There were many, many days where I did not see that being anywhere near close to reality, but still that was the promise. So God's promise, and Jesus' promise in this story, is that this sickness will not end in death, right? So what is God's promise to you? And if you don't know that yet, I encourage you to spend time asking God and seeking him. God, what are you saying to me? What are you promising me? What do you want me to stand on? And so later down, it says in verse 5, now Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus. So when he heard that Lazarus was sick, he stayed where he was 2 more days. And then he said to his disciples, let's go back to Judea. But Rabbi, they said, a short while ago, the Jews there tried to stone you, and you're going back? Because Jesus loved them, he went back to the very place where he was previously, you know, they attempted to stone him at risk to his personal safety, but he chose to go back because he loved them and meet them in their place of grief. And sometimes God is calling us to arrive and meet people in their place of grief, and it's not going to be convenient or comfortable, but still he asks us to do that. So he goes back to Judea, and then he meets Martha in her grief. And it says in verse 21, Lord, Martha said to Jesus, if you had been there, my brother would not have died. Because at this point, Lazarus, as I'm sure you know, died, right? But I know that even now God will give you whatever you ask. And Jesus said to her, your brother will rise again. So he responds to Martha by reiterating the promise that this sickness will not end in death. Your brother will rise again. And, you know, Martha responds the way many of us do. Jesus, where were you? If you had been there, this wouldn't have happened. If you had been there, my marriage wouldn't fall apart. If you had been there, I wouldn't have lost this person. If you had been there, they wouldn't have died. Where were you, Jesus? She responds the way many of us do. Jesus doesn't condemn her for that. He can handle those questions. He can handle that anger. angst and that pain, and he meets us in that place of pain. And with Martha, he reminds her of his promise. But what's interesting is we see later in verse 32, Jesus meets Mary in her grief. And it says, when Mary reached the place where Jesus was and saw him, she fell at his feet and said, Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. So she actually responds very similar to the way Martha did, right? And then Jesus says, saw her weeping, and the Jews who had come along with her also weeping. He was deeply moved in spirit and troubled. Where have you laid him? He asked. Come and see, Lord, they replied. Jesus wept. Jesus wept with them. He was deeply troubled and moved by their grief, and he wept with them, knowing full well the miracle that he was about to perform, but that did not prevent him from meeting Mary and the others in their place of grief and weeping with them. And he goes with them directly to the place where Lazarus' dead body is in the tomb, which is not, I mean, I have been to a tomb in Israel, you know, where they put bodies, but I've never smelled a dead body in a tomb, thank you, Jesus. But from what I've heard, it's actually a place filled with stench and not a very pleasant place that you would want to go. And yet Jesus goes there, and he doesn't go to the graveside of Lazarus and say, hey guys, stop crying. Let's put up streamers and balloons. We're having a party because this is going to turn out great, right? He could have done that. And yet he doesn't. He meets them with compassion in their place of grief, and he grieves with them, knowing full well that he's going to perform a miracle and that Lazarus will not stay dead. And sure enough, he does that very thing. And it's interesting because Jesus shows up very differently for Martha and for Mary, right? For Martha, he reminds her of the promise. And for Mary, he grieves with her and he weeps with her. And so there's not a one-size-fits-all Band-Aid for grief. And, you know, some people talk about the stages of grief. I've heard and tend to believe that that's sort of a myth, because I wish that grief followed just a neat little like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 and I'm done. But I actually went through a program through the Grief Recovery Institute. It's called the Grief Recovery Method. If any of you guys are dealing with grief, I encourage you to look it up. It's really awesome. And it's run by Christians, and it's really, really, really wonderful. But there's not a one-size-fits-all approach to, you know, grief healing. And so Jesus meets them each differently in their place of grief. And since you and I are called to mourn with those who mourn, we're not going to just show up for every person the same way. And if we're not sure about what they need, we can ask, right? Rather than just assuming what the person wants is in that morning is a pep talk, in that moment is a pep talk. Usually it's not. Usually when I'm grieving, I don't want a pep talk, right? And at the same time, I had friends who were willing to sit with me in my grief and cry with me. And then they knew when the Holy Spirit was prompting them to remind me, Harmony, God said he would restore family to you. He said he would redeem the dream. And I believe that he's going to do that. But they wouldn't do that instead of grieving with me because they were uncomfortable, right? Does that make sense? You guys are kind of like, what? We're going to be talking about Jesus and joy. We are. and grief, because he's with us. And the thing about it, in the story of Lazarus, there is grief, but there is also hope. There was always hope. The embodiment of hope was present in this story, in their lives, in this situation, the entire time. There was always hope, but there was also grief. And hope and grief are not mutually exclusive. They can coexist. They can happen simultaneously. So I ask you to consider, is there unresolved grief in your life that needs to be addressed? Is there something that God is calling you to grieve? Not fun, but important. Is there someone in your life, especially during this holiday season, it can be such a difficult time. Is there someone in your life that God is calling you to show up for, and they're grieving? And ask him to show you how to show up for them as well, because maybe what they need isn't a pep talk, but maybe they just need to be invited to sit on your couch or sit at your table and have a meal. Or for you to sit and cry with them. I don't know, but God will show you. So the third thing is that hope waits. This is another favorite thing. You guys are never going to have me back. I'm like grieving, waiting, like everyone's favorite things, grieving and waiting. actually, so after my separation, I needed a word from God. And I knew biblically I had the right to divorce my ex-husband. And yet, that is not necessarily what God calls all of us to do when an affair happens, right? And I know my God is a redeemer, and I know that he restores, and I know that he was fully capable of restoring my marriage, right? And yet, there is another human in the equation with free will. I wasn't willing to stay in a marriage and just be cheated on or treated poorly, but I was open to the idea that God would restore and reconcile if that was his will. And so I needed to know, God, what are you asking me to do? Are you asking me to stay or are you asking me to go? Do I divorce? Do I not, right? I need an answer. I fasted and prayed, and I went on this fast that was supposed to be 6 weeks, and I kept going because I was like, I'm going to fast until I hear a word from the Lord. Just to be clear, I was eating food. It wasn't that kind of water fast. Like, I can't do that. Not even when I'm not pregnant, right? So, but after like 80 days of this particular fast that I was on, I still hadn't heard a word from God. All I kept hearing was wait, 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 wait on me, take a posture of strength. Wait on me, take a posture of strength. And by like day 83 or something, I was over it and I was exhausted and I just wanted to hear a word from God. And so I went up to this person who was speaking at church and I said to him, because he spoke this whole message on when you need a word from God, you ask confidently. So I go to him and I'm like, I've been asking. I'm like 83 days into a fast and I've been asking, do I stay or do I go? I just need to know. What does he want me to do? And all I keep hearing is wait. And I'll never forget, he said, do you think God is just like, wants you to be groveling at his feet about this? He's gonna give you an answer. And then he goes like this, and he goes, and besides, wait is a word. I was like, oh, dang it. That's, wait is a word. I wanted the yes or the no, but so many times we want the yes or the no, the go or the stay, the green light, the red light, and God is like, yellow light, wait, like, caution, hold on. You know, I guess, is that red light? I don't know, whatever. The point is, wait. It's this horrible in-between place, right? I don't know about you, but I like to get things done. Like yesterday, my husband makes fun of me because like I get stuff done, right? But not always accurately, but it's done. Because I just love checking lists and moving forward and let's keep going, right? And so the waiting place is not my favorite place. It's one of my least favorite places. And it was about a year and a half of waiting before God released me to divorce that man. And I have to say, at certain points, I got so frustrated. I was like, God, why am I waiting on him? He's still continuing to cheat. He's still continuing to choose addiction. And why am I waiting on him? And God showed me, you're not waiting on him. You're waiting on me. I was like, okay. That's a different story then, right? And here's the thing. So then when I finally was released to divorce, I'm the only person in California that's been denied a divorce. I was denied the divorce 5 times. So that was more time to wait. Like people here can get divorced after like 5 minutes of being married, right? I don't know what happened, but all I can assume is that it was God's sovereign hand helping create space in my life for me to continue to wait. Because he knows me. I would have wanted to move on too fast. But as long as I was stuck in this waiting place in this marriage, I wasn't going to jump into another relationship because I had made a vow and I was choosing to honor that vow, although my husband didn't, right? So I was in this in-between waiting place. And God used it to do the most incredible, beautiful work in me. And I wouldn't ever want to go through that again, but I would never trade the pain of the waiting. I would never trade that grief for the beautiful work of healing that God has done in my life. And I'm a better person because of it. I'm a better leader because of it. I'm a better mother because of it, because he did a work in the waiting place. And he wants to do a work in you in your waiting places. They are not fun. Wait for the Lord, be strong and take heart and wait for the Lord, Psalm 27:14. And we are in a culture where we want instant results. We like microwaves. I don't know about you, but I wish I could go to the gym for like 2 weeks and have a six pack. But that's not the way it works, unless you're my husband. He's like, oh my gosh, I just lifted weights 3 times and my biceps are back. And I have abs again. And I'm like, that's not fair. But for the rest of us, we can't go to the gym 3 times and expect immediate results, right? There is a process. And the way it works is seed, time, harvest. And we don't like the time part, right? And the hard part about the seed time is that many times the seeds are planted deep in the dark earth where we cannot see, where we just have to hope and trust that harvest will come, that the seed will one day flower, that it will break through the soil of the earth, and that God's promises will come to pass, right? And not knowing when. Anne Voskamp wrote this, it's an excerpt from a blog that she wrote, and I want to read it to you. Good always necessitates long waiting. Every tulip only blossoms after cold months of winter wait. Every human ever furled into existence through 9 long months, that it's actually like 9 months and 2 weeks, by the way, of the womb waiting. And only the king, and the only kingdom that will last for eternity still waits this millennia-long, unwavering hope for return of its king. Instead of chafing, we accept that waiting is a strand in the DNA of the body of Christ, that this waiting on God is the very real work of the people of God. Waiting on God is the very real work of the people of God. And the reason that we can wait is because we trust him. Trusting him enables us to wait on him, because we trust that he is good, because we trust that his plans are good, because we trust that his character is good and that he wants good for our life. That is what empowers us to wait on him, because otherwise we're gonna wanna get ahead of him, right? So hope waits, and hope waits because hope trusts. I'm so glad I waited. I'm so glad I didn't try to get ahead of God. I wouldn't have been ready for this marriage, or any marriage for that matter, 2 seconds sooner, because the work wouldn't have been complete. And already, you know, marriage, it's work, right? Does anybody know that? No? Okay, just us? Okay. But I wouldn't have been ready if I hadn't waited. So, in closing, hope looks very different depending on where we place it. So where is your hope today? Where is your hope? Hope and grief are not mutually exclusive. They coexist. You can hope and you can grieve. This happens together. So is there something that you need to grieve? Or is there someone in your life that needs you to grieve with them and to show up for them in their place of grief? And finally, hope waits. Hope waits because hope trusts, because we know that God is good and that his character can be trusted. And despite the circumstances in our world, despite the circumstances in our lives, he is still good and he is still on the throne. Thank you so much for having me.